dang straight.
The Legislature Today Show is brought to you by the North Dakota Association of Oil and Gas Producing Counties. Online at ndenergy.org. The Credit Union Association of the Dakotas, creating awareness about the benefits of credit unions. The University of Mary, America's Leadership University. And the North Dakota Corn, Soybean, and Grain Growers Association, as well as the North Dakota Ethanol Council. And now back to the Legislature Today with your host, Dale Wetzel.
This is the Legislature Today radio program. We're coming to you from the Peacock Alley American Bar and Grill in downtown Bismarck, North Dakota. A second half hour of our show, we're going to be talking about raw milk, which is a elegant way of describing milk that has not been pasteurized, or in other words, not been heated to kill germs.
Or homogenized for your protection.
That gentleman that just spoke is Senator Joe Miller. He is a Republican from Park River, North Dakota, in the northeast part of North Dakota, and he is the chairman of the Senate Agriculture Committee. We also have with us Representative Dwight Kiefert. He is a Republican from Valley City. He's a farmer and a new member of the legislature. He's serving his first session. Both of these gentlemen are on a conference committee, which is a group of three House members and three senators who are working out the final details of a bill to regulate, in a manner of speaking, raw milk transactions in North Dakota. And the conference committee met this afternoon, and I understand that they've worked out a deal. First of all, welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Good to be here.
Secondly, what does this final bill say? What does it do?
Well, it essentially all it does is just say this is what a herd share or cow share is, which is kind of how the sale of raw milk is being utilized. I shouldn't call it the sale, but it basically says that raw milk's okay if you do it this way. And what I kind of view it as is you buy half a cow, half a steer for your own consumption of the beef. You can go directly to the farm and say, I need a half or a quarter beef, and the farmer, okay. Well, then he sells another half or a quarter to somebody else, and then you get your beef, and you just take it to the local locker plant, and they butcher it, and you get your own beef. And essentially that's how this herd share agreement works out, is you enter into a contract and say, I take ownership of part of this milk-bearing cow, and I get the milk out of it, and it's unpasteurized, unhomogenized, fresh off the farm milk. And some people think that's important health food to drink and consume. And I guess what we finally said in conference committee is that's okay. You just go right ahead.
Representative Kiefert, what's been the response of some of the folks who like raw milk to this approach?
Well, it's I think kind of bring people up to speed on how this all came about is that like 28 states it's legal to purchase raw milk, and North Dakota happened to be one of the states that they said it was illegal to purchase raw milk. So in order for people to get raw milk, like they said, Representative Miller said that they're buying their own cow, having somebody else milk it to obtain their milk. So that's how this all came about. But there's approximately 3% of our population is drinking raw milk, and that population is increasing like 25% per year. So in North Dakota, we have between 18 and 22,000 people that want the right to drink raw milk. And this all came about by the Ag Department decided they were going to regulate this. And the first attempt was to make the cow share program illegal. And that's what really got people going. The emails were flying because they were trying to take people's right away. And that's what was being perceived as a government intrusion on your private rights. So that's how this got going. But I've had more emails, more contacts, probably three times as many as any other subjects since we've been here.
More than abortion?
Probably twice as many.
Really? Okay. And what does the final bill, what does it do in terms of requiring like any sort of reporting of whether you're selling or whether you have a cow share agreement or whether you
well, the people
money.
That enter into the cow share agreement have an agreement between the person that's taking care of their animal, and that's the only agreement that they have. This the amendments don't require any registry or anything. It's just recognizing that what they're doing is legal, and it's going to restrict the Ag Department from doing any restrictions on it. And we also put in there a study to look at legalizing the sale of raw milk, so then the Agriculture Department can come in and do the regulatory rules and do whatever they want. But like I say, like in California, you go to the grocery store, buy it over the counter. It's just that North Dakota, for whatever the reason, they passed a law saying it's illegal to sell raw milk.
Senator Miller, was there ever a push during the progress of this bill to make the sales of raw milk legal in North Dakota?
Well, we never heard that. You know, this bill originated simply as the biennium update to the milk code. You know, every so often we have to update our rules regarding the regulation of milk. There's federal rules, and we just say every couple of years we change that date from 2011 to 2013, and that's what we started to do. It's always a simple bill, no big deal. And the Ag Department came in, and they said, you know, we need some direction with this issue because otherwise we're going to start regulating it. So whatever you guys want us to do, just tell us, because they were getting some pushback from the Health Department and that area, and they needed to know what their direction needed to be, because they are responsible for regulating dairies, as are the Health Department, and they need to know, do we regulate this, do we shut it down, or what do? Is it we treat it as a normal dairy? And so that was the whole point of the amendments to the bill. And this, we already passed the bill out of the Senate by the time it got to the House. That's when they introduced the amendments on it. So I kind of felt compelled that we probably should have a conference committee on the issue. And we came up with an idea that, okay, we'll say, so long as you're a dairy that's currently being regulated by the, you have to report if you're doing herd shares or not. Well, then that got to the House floor, and Dwight stood up and said, you know, we don't need to do this at all. And House agreed, so we brought it back into the conference committee, and now we've come up with this agreement that we're just going to say, okay, this is what a herd share is, and it's fine to do.
Do you think that there's going to be any problem in the Senate with getting these provisions through?
I don't think so. I think most people just have a feeling of, you know, this is something that private individuals knowingly engage in, and that's their own prerogative. The whole issue of pasteurization began many years ago because as the country became more urban, there was demand for milk, and people couldn't have cows, and the health risk of drinking raw milk when they had poor refrigeration, unsanitary conditions, unsanitary water, all these things that, you know, that compounded into a need for pasteurization, because otherwise they just couldn't keep milk from spoiling and getting people sick. And that's why pasteurization and homogenization took root, is because they needed to uniformly be able to distribute milk to people that demanded it.
Have either of you gentlemen drunk raw milk?
I grew up on it, I guess. We had a grade A dairy farm, and that's all we drank on the farm. And when we didn't have a dairy, we bought it from a neighbor by the cream can full. So that's all we've ever known on the farm.
I don't remember if I have or not, but I may have.
I mean, what's the difference, Representative Kiefer, what's the difference between the milk you buy in the store and unpasteurized milk?
Well, it's pretty much sterilized. And one thing that people have to understand is that pasteurizing milk doesn't make good milk. It makes bad milk drinkable. And that's what was happening back in the 1800s. In fact, if you read about it, some of these practices they had, some of the people were actually putting their feet in the milk bucket while they were milking the cow to keep their feet warm. That's where the bad milk came from. But if you pasteurized that milk, it made that milk drinkable. So you've always had good milk and bad milk, but that's what the pasteurizing does. It cooks everything out of it. But then you lose all the valuable nutrients in it too. And more people are realizing the benefits of the raw milk. In fact, there's a large portion of our population is allergic to pasteurized milk. They have lactose intolerance. But almost 80% of the people that are lactose intolerant have no trouble drinking raw milk. So there's a lot of things we probably don't understand about all the benefits of raw milk, but there's actually studies going on with connections like to autism and raw milk, because we're naturally mammals. We're made to drink milk. So if you feed your kids white liquid that used to be milk, they're not getting any of the benefits out of it. So there could be some possible connections to other problems we're having.
What do you think that this will help the dairy industry in North Dakota, this movement toward more consumption of raw milk?
I don't know. I think the dairy industry probably, they probably view it in a way, well, they're heavily regulated, and they probably don't necessarily like the idea that somebody's getting by, skating by like that. That doesn't preclude them from entering into a herd share agreement. I think as far as they're concerned, as long as they can sell milk product and people are drinking milk, that's what they want. You know, cheese, milk, any kind of dairy product, that's what they want. So whatever that takes, that's what's best for them.
What does this law do for the, like, raw cheese, other dairy products that are made from milk?
Well, I don't know much about the cheese making process.
I'm just wondering, does this make it any easier or less difficult to obtain cheese made from raw milk?
Well, I think once they have the raw milk, they can process it any way they want. Yeah. But I don't think you can make, like, cottage cheese out of pasteurized milk. I remember my mom used to make cottage cheese out of the raw milk on the farm, and they used to skim the cream off to make butter. And you can't do that with the processed milk.
They must do that in another step. I really don't know how they... That would be a good science project.
How common is North Dakota's regime of allowing cow shares but not allowing the sale of raw milk?
Well, it kind of looks to me like, you can't buy bottle rockets here either. But you can go to South Dakota, you can buy raw milk, you can buy bottle rockets, but if you come back to North Dakota, you can't bring the milk. You can bring the explosives home, but federal regulations prohibits the interstate transportation of raw milk. Well, it's just something that, like I say, 28 states, it's legal. It's just North Dakota's preference. Whoever presented the bill, whoever passed it is...
up until this point, I just don't think it's been much of an issue. It's just most people don't really think about it. If they wanted, they buy their milk in the store, and that's all they care about. But there's this health food natural movement. They want to get more farm direct products, and people think that there's health benefits to that, so that's their angle, and more power to them. I don't have a problem. Like Dwight, there's plenty of dairy, probably just about every dairy farmer you can meet out there that relative to size probably drinks raw milk every day. I know most of the guys I know drink their own milk. So I think they realize that there's benefit to it. So, it's a good process.
To what extent, I was thinking about the price of milk in North Dakota is regulated. Is the price of raw milk regulated?
Well, they don't sell per gallon. They sell a share, and I don't know how they base that. I didn't bother to ask. That's their own. They can sell it for wherever they want.
There was some elements of the bill that I thought were interesting. If you have a herd share or a cow share, you have to provide the person who has that share copies of the standards of care used for the dairy cows, copies of milk production standards, the results of any tests on the dairy cows, and the results of any tests on the milk. Was there any problem with any of that in terms of requiring that?
Well, the original amendments dealt with registry and whatnot, but that's what we're looking at here. We're looking at having your own cow, having your own milk, so we didn't want to have the government get in what you're doing with your own milk. We're not selling raw milk. So that's what I have maintained all along. If they want to regulate raw milk sales, then let's legalize it, and then we can do testing, requirements, whatever. But like other states, they legalize it first and then do all their regulation. So it's kind of a backdoor way of trying to regulate people that have their own cows drinking their own milk.
There was a part of the bill that says that the Ag Commissioner can't impose additional rules governing raw milk production. What was the reason for that?
Well, I can address that. See, since the beginning, the Amendment 1 was to make it illegal. We dropped out like a hot potato. That wasn't going to happen. But then after that, they started backing off. They were going to make it illegal for a grade A dairy to participate. Then they dropped that. Then they thought maybe make it illegal for a grade B. The way it looks to me is like they were just trying to get their foot in the door to get things started on regulations, and then they could expand after that. And that's what the people were afraid of. They didn't want any regulations because the government shouldn't be there. It's your cow, your milk, and why should they be telling you what to do with it?
What's the difference between a grade A and a grade B dairy?
Grade A is the milk you drink. Grade B is the milk you make cheese and other manufacturing grades, essentially what they call it, and that's... It's really the only difference. There's the bacteria content, essentially the cleanliness of the natural milk is kind of how it sort of comes about, and that might just be the type of cows, the type of feed. It could be the environment in which things are stored, but you know, you're talking about parts per million, and I mean it's really a small change. It's not to say that grade B is disgusting or gross or something like that.
And even your water supply comes into factor too, because the grade B might have cleaner milk than grade A, but if you don't have the water supply that meets the standards for grade A, then you can't sell grade A. You can't get the license for that.
What is the we talked about health benefits of raw milk. I mean, what do the people who drink it, what do they think that the health benefits are?
Well, I've heard all kinds of things from, you know, my banker. He said that he had a nephew who was in a bad accident and got just scarred up, and he had owned a dairy, and you know, they drank raw milk, and he recovered very fast, and he just swears that it was because he was drinking raw milk. And it was, you know, he got natural fats and calcium, and it's just like eating raw vegetables in a sense, if you want to think about it that way. You know, there's, you don't have that conversion in the chemical process through heat, and so there's different things that are available. Now when you pasteurize milk, now that becomes a different state, just as you cook meat, and there's different health benefits to that too. But you know, it's raw versus cooked, essentially.
What you're coming up with then, it's what used to be milk. It's a white liquid, and if you look at your container, it says vitamin fortified. Well, they put the vitamins back in, but it's all been cooked out of it. So it's not really milk you're drinking. It's a white liquid that used to be milk.
How popular is raw milk in North Dakota? Do we have any data on this?
3% of the national population is what I've read, and that would equate to 6 million people in the U.S., and that would mean 18,000 in North Dakota. And I received some numbers that said like 22,000 in North Dakota.
Highly doubt it's that high, just because there aren't that many people engaged in this process of milk shares, and I don't know where else they would get it. I'm sure there's plenty of people that have their own cow. I know there's folks that live on a farm, they'll buy a milk cow just for this purpose. And then there's people that have dairies, but there aren't that many dairies, and there's only like 180 dairies in North Dakota. So, yeah, I mean, there could be as many as 22,000, but I'd say there's probably more around maybe 5 or 10. Who knows? That's not something we calculate. So,
let's just say I'm a city person. I want to drink raw milk. I want to get some. Can it be delivered to me? I mean, how can I obtain it?
I believe there's a Bartlett Farms. That's exactly what they do. You buy a herd share and they'll enter this contract, and then they'll deliver it to you if it's economically feasible for them to do that.
Is there anything in this law that prevents things of that nature, like deliveries of milk?
Not anymore. There was some language earlier, but that's all been stripped out.
And can you buy raw milk for, like, to feed to your cats or feed to animals?
I believe, according to this, you can buy raw milk as pet food right now. You can go to any dairy and buy that if they want to sell it to you. I know some guys have said for some of these large dairies, it's not really a it's more of a hassle than anything to go and get a gallon of milk or 5 gallons of milk out of their tank, because they'll probably spill 10 in the process. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it would be a process for people to do, but if you look at the difference in prices, I've heard that some of these people are paying up to $20 a gallon, you know, what the cost by owning the cow and paying them. So that's one way where the dairies could, you know, recover a lot more money per gallon. But I think that might be part of what the problem is, that they're kind of scared that some of these dairy farms might start doing that. But they could probably get 10 times as much for the product as they do by selling it to a manufacturer.
How much, how is the milk dispensed? I mean, do you get quart bottles, gallon bottles?
I really don't know.
You have an agreement with your herd share person, so I think whatever you guys decide on, if you want gallons or quarts, but that'd be your agreement between the person that's taking care of your cow.
Okay. And so what do you think this law will do, if anything, to the popularity of raw milk consumption in North Dakota? Do you think it'll affect it, or
I really honestly don't see it changing the trend. Right now there's a lot of interest in raw milk, and that'll probably continue. But, there's guys that have been doing it. It's not really a change in law, because before it was perfectly legal. This just continues the fact that it's legal. It's up to the consumers. They have a choice. People just got to realize that there's sometimes inherent dangers in drinking raw milk, and that's why we pasteurize it. And that's just it.
Are you surprised at this? I got a lot of email about this issue, and Representative Kiefer, you mentioned you got more about it than abortion, which I thought was like led the hit parade in terms of email. Are you surprised, you gentlemen, that this got this much attention?
Yes and no. I mean, it's just kind of one of those issues where people, it's important to them, and I think, it's one of those issues where folks are concerned about overregulation of government, and this was exactly when this issue came up. They're like, okay, now they're trying to shut us down. And so, you build the wall, you surround the circle the wagons, and that was it. It's like, don't let them enter our domain. And I think that's what happened. And we got the message, and we put a study in the bill too, so we can continue looking at this if we think there's a problem. And I just don't feel it to be a problem. I just don't think it's something that we really need to get involved in.
Yeah, if I could add, I say like the population that's drinking raw milk is increasing 25% per year. And one thing about the emails we got on this, they were from Dickinson, Mandan, Bismarck. They weren't from like states, a long ways away. They were all local email. So there's a lot of people that are doing this, and I think that you're seeing more organic gardens. People want to get their vegetables without pesticides. People are scared of generic or the genetically modified grains. They're scared of that, and so the trend has been more to going to the organic farming. That's what you're looking at with the raw milk.
Do you think that eventually that North Dakota will make the sale of raw milk legal? Is that where this is leading?
Well, hopefully the study will look at doing that. If there's enough demand, I think if we would have brought that bill to the floor in the House today, we would have passed it.
Yeah, I don't know what will happen. It could very well lead to that. I think it's just a matter of what the public wants. I mean, we live to serve here, and that's what it is.
Well, the gentleman you've been listening to is Senator Joe Miller. He's a Republican from Park River, which is in northeastern North Dakota. He is the chairman of the Senate Agriculture Committee. We've also had with us this evening Representative Dwight Kiefert. He's a new member of the legislature. He's a Republican from Valley City. And we've been talking to these two gentlemen about legislation to regulate raw milk and its availability to North Dakota consumers. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Good to be here.
And we'll be coming to you tomorrow with other subjects of the North Dakota legislature. It looks as if we've got more than a week left.
Today I'm here to tell you about American Family Insurance's